Hello everyone, I'm Rupali Meshram. Welcome to my YouTube channel. Please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon for my latest updates. Good morning students. Today we are going to see Standard 6th Geography Chapter 5 Temperature. Do it yourself. Take a torch light and keep it stable at one place. Take two large paper sheets large enough to accommodate its entire beam. Paste the papers on two flat boards. Hold the board perpendicular to the beam. See figure 5.1a. Draw the outline of the area lit up by the beam. Name the paper A. Now, use the other paper. Hold it in such a way that it makes an angle of 120 degree with the beam. See figure 5.1b. Draw the outline of the area occupied by the beam. Name the paper B. Observe both the papers A and B. After observing, you have to find out few questions answer and compare your answer with my answers. First question. On which paper does the beam occupy a large area? You will see that the beam occupies a large area on the paper that is held in such a way that it makes an angle of 120 degree with the beam. On which paper is the area smaller? You will get the answer. The area is smaller on the paper that is held in such a way that it makes an angle of 90 degree, that is perpendicular with the beam. Now, change the angle between the beam of light and the paper. Observe the changes that occur in the area occupied by the beam of light. Now answer this question. What is the relation between the angle of the paper and the area occupied by the beam? You will get answer that when the angle of paper with the beam is of less degree, the area occupied by the beam is smaller. On the other hand, when the angle of paper with the beam is of more degree, the area occupied by the beam is larger. Explanation for the activity. Sun rays coming towards the earth travel in straight lines. However, as the earth is spherical in shape, these are not perpendicular to all the parts of the earth's surface. In some parts, they are perpendicular, whereas in other parts they are slanting. Let us see what effect it has on the earth. The perpendicular rays occupy less area. Figure 5.1a. The part where the rays occupy lesser area receives bright sunshine and greater heat. Hence, the surface there gets heated more and the air becomes hotter. The slant areas occupy a large area. Figure 5.1b. In this area, sunlight appears less bright and there is less heat. Hence, the surface there gets less heated and the air too is less hot. Do it yourself. The region marked A in figure 5.2 receives perpendicular rays, while the region marked B receives slant rays, and in the region marked C the rays are extremely slanting. Using a scale, measure the length of the lit up portion on the earth's surface. In A, B and C regions, measure the width of the rays shown between the earth and the sun. Considering the parallels of latitude marked in the figure, Tell the regions where the temperature will be high, moderate and low. You will get answer that the temperature will be high in the regions receiving perpendicular sun rays and the temperature will be moderate in the regions receiving slant sun rays. The temperature will be low in the regions receiving extremely slanting sun rays. Explanation of this activity. Sun rays falling on the earth are straight and parallel to each other. You can observe this in the given diagram. However, we have seen that due to the spherical shape of the earth and the resultant curvature of the surface, they occupy a large or lesser area. This leads to unequal distribution of the heat received from the sun, resulting in decreasing temperature from the equator to the north and south poles. Based on the distribution of temperature, the earth can be divided into torrid, temperate and frigid zones or tropical, temperate and polar regions. Try to understand this from figure 2.4 and 5.3. Though latitude is the main factor, there are other factors also which influence the distribution of temperature. However, their effects are limited to a particular region. These factors are as follows: nearness to the sea, continentality, height above the mean sea level and physical setup of a region are factors that lead to diversity in the climate of that regions. Other than these factors like cloud cover, winds, vegetation cover, urbanization, industrialization, etc. also influences the local climate. Let us perform an experiment to see that there is a difference in the heating and cooling of land and water. Do it yourself. Take two pots of the same size and fill them with water equally. At sunrise, keep one of the pot inside the house and the other one outside. See that it remains in the sun all the time as shown in figure 5.4b. In the afternoon, walk barefoot on the floor inside the house and feel the temperature of the floor. Feel the temperature of water in the pot inside. Perform the same activity outside the house and get the feel of the temperature of land and the water kept in the sun. Write down your observation about the temperatures of land and water. Do this again around 7 in the evening. Note your observation again. Now you can remove the pots. During this activity, you must have realized that the land cools down earlier than the water. The water kept outside in the sun is still a little warm. Due to this difference in the heating and cooling of land and water, the air over the land gets heated faster and also becomes cooler rapidly. The air over the water gets heated slowly and also loses to heat in a slower manner. In the coastal areas, as compared to continental areas, the temperature of air is lower during the day but warmer at night. Contrary to this, the temperature of air in the continental areas is higher during daytime and lower at night. In the coastal areas, because of the heating of seawater, water vapor gets mixed in the air. This water vapor holds the heat in the air. As a result, the air in the coastal areas remains moist and warm. conditions in the continental areas are the opposite. As water vapor is absent, the air remains dry. This leads to sharp differences in the day and night temperatures. The difference in the maximum and minimum temperatures of a day is called diurnal range of temperature. In short, the difference in the day and night temperatures is less in the coastal areas and more in the continental areas. For example, Mumbai temperatures are even, but at Nagpur they vary a lot. In the coastal region of Konkan, the range of temperature is less, but in Vidarbha, the range of temperature is found to be higher. Therefore, coastal areas have an equable climate, whereas in continental areas, the climate is extreme. For example, the climate of Mumbai is equable, whereas in continental location like Nagpur, it is extreme. The difference in the mean temperatures of summer and winter is called annual range of temperature. Always remember, we normally think that air gets heated due to the sun's rays, and because of the hot air, the land and water gets heated. But in reality, what happens is as follows. First, land and water gets heated due to sun rays. Later, they radiate into the atmosphere. The heat that they have absorbed, as a result, the layer of air close to the surface gets heated. The heat gets transferred vertically to the adjacent upper layers of the air. Hence, air closer to the surface is hotter, and as one moves higher up from the surface, the temperature of the air decreases. The temperature near the sea level is higher, and it decreases in the mountainous regions. Do you know effect of greenhouse gases? Some gases in the atmosphere like carbon dioxide and water vapor can hold the heat within themselves for a long period of time. Due to these gases, the temperature of air in the atmosphere increases. The increasing proportion of these gases in the atmosphere leads to climate change. Climate scientists believe that this is the reason for the increasing temperature of the earth. This change in climate is global. This is called global rise in temperature. The gases due to which the temperature increases are called greenhouse gases. Do it yourself. A pot with water is placed on a burner. Drop 4 to 5 small plastic buttons in it and observe their movements in water. Figure 5.5. You will observe that water expands on heating. The hot water from the base moves upwards. With it, the buttons too are pushed towards the surface. The relatively cooler water in the upper portion moves downwards, taking the buttons with it. This happens repeatedly. In other words, on heating, an upward current sets in the water. In nature, the conditions are slightly different. Due to temperature difference, both upward and horizontal currents develop in the ocean. Besides temperature differences, factors like winds and differences in the density of water also give rise to horizontal currents. These ocean currents flow from the equator to the polar region and from the polar region to the equator. See figure 5.6. When an ocean current flows from the frigid to the torrid zone, it reduces the temperature of the coast in the torrid zone. When a current flows from the torrid to the frigid zone, It increases the temperatures of the coast in the frigid zone. You know, the regions where warm and cold currents converge are favorable for the growth of planktons. Planktons are the food for fishes. Fish from other areas travel towards these areas in large numbers. They breed in warm waters due to high concentration of fish population. Fisheries thrive well in these areas. In the map of ocean currents given in 5.6, locates such regions. Find their names from an atlas or the internet. Write the names on the map. Considering the temperatures of various places on the earth, maps of global distribution are prepared. Figure 5.7 is drawn with the help of isotherms. Isotherms are lines that connect places with the same temperature. After avoiding the effects of height, these lines generally appear parallel to the latitudes on a world map. Observe the isotherm of 25 degrees Celsius in the map. This line occupies areas close to the equator. The shape of this line appears like an ellipse on the map. The north to south spread of this ellipse is greater on the continents as compared to the ocean. The isotherm line occupies some parts of the continents of South America, Africa, Asia, and Australia. A very limited portion of the Pacific Ocean is occupied by this isotherm. You will find two isotherms with a label of 0 degrees Celsius. Observe them. The 0 degrees Celsius isotherm from the southern hemisphere is largely straight and is parallel to the line of latitude. Comparatively, the line of the same value in the northern hemisphere divides north and south considerably. In the west, the parts of the Pacific Ocean, it is fairly straight, but when it enters the continent of North America, it turns somewhat to the north. Then the line proceeds eastwards. Within a short distance after entering the Atlantic Ocean, it turns towards the northeast. In this part, you will find all the isotherm lines turning towards the northeast. This is because a warm ocean current is located in this area. Further, after entering Eurasia, while moving eastwards, it turns somewhat to the southeast. Still, further in the Pacific Ocean, most of the isotherm lines appear moving eastwards as straight lines. The isotherms in the southern hemisphere are fairly parallel to the latitudinal lines. From South Pole to the Tropic of Capricorn, the distance between these lines is almost equal. As the proportion of land in the southern hemisphere is limited, temperatures in these parts are largely influenced by latitude. In the northern hemisphere, the distance between these lines varies. In this hemisphere, the proportion of land is comparatively greater. This affects the distribution of temperature. These effects are seen in the form of variations in the distance between the isotherms and curved nature of these lines. Can you tell? Answer the following questions by observing the given figure 5.8. First question, what is the tube of the thermometer fixed on? You will observe that the tube of the thermometer is fixed on a wooden strip. What substance is used in the thermometer tube? You will see mercury or alcohol is used in the thermometer tube. What do the figures on the scale indicate? You will see that the figures on the scale indicate temperature. In which different units is the temperature measured? You will see that the temperature is measured in Celsius and Fahrenheit. How much temperature is shown in the figure? Temperature shown in figure is 38 degrees Celsius. What season does the temperature in the figure indicate? The temperature in the figure indicates the summer season. Thermometer. Different types of thermometers are used for measuring the temperature of air. Mercury or alcohol is used in the thermometers. The freezing point of mercury is minus 39 degrees Celsius, whereas that of alcohol is minus 130 degrees Celsius. These materials are highly sensitive to temperature variation. Therefore, variations in temperature from minus 30 degrees Celsius to plus 55 degrees Celsius can easily be observed with the help of these materials. The units of measuring temperature are degrees Celsius or degrees Fahrenheit, as shown in the figure. These are expressed as degrees Celsius or degree Fahrenheit. The difference in daily temperatures maximum or to minimum can be observed with the help of a thermometer. Air temperature is measured in Celsius.